Good morning, and welcome to the City of Aurora. It is our distinct honor to host two State of Illinois bill signing ceremonies today here in Aurora, including this one for House Bill 562, appropriately being held here at the Aurora Police Department headquarters. Thank you to Governor Pritzker, Attorney General Raul, Speaker Welsh, Senator Kohler, and all the members of the General Assembly who are present, the dignitaries from throughout the state, and to those who have sacrificed to make this bill a reality. On behalf of the Aurora City Council, many of whom are present today, the Aurora Police Department and Chief Zeman, who you will hear from shortly, and all the people of Aurora and beyond whose lives were forever changed 899 days ago. It was on that day, February 15th, 2019, that Governor Pritzker, Chief Zeman, and I stood shoulder to shoulder in this very room that we stand in today, literally hours after the Henry Pratt tragedy that shook us to the core. On that fateful day, a murderer armed with a gun and a revoked FOID card injured five of our Aurora police officers and took the lives of five innocent human beings: Russell Beyer, Vicente Juarez, Clayton Parks, Josh Pinkert, and Trevor Warner. Let us have a moment of silence in their memory. As the detail of that tragedy were later revealed, it became clear that it could possibly have been prevented, and certainly any future tragedies could be prevented through an overhaul and strengthening of the FOID card process. We return here today, 2.5 years later, with more than a commitment to do just that. We return with new laws and procedures to not only prevent future tragedies, but laws that will also hopefully let the families of these five gentlemen who lost their lives, let them know that they will never be forgotten. Thank you to the stalwart voices of those in this room who took up the mantle of leadership for this worthy cause, including Abby Parks, the widow of Clayton Parks, who is here today with us. Ma'am, thank you for your strength and courage. We also have with us today the parents of Trevor, Tom Warner, and Bonnie Rich. Thank you both for being with us today. Thank you to the bold legislators who made this decisive action, dotted the I's and crossed the T's, and crossed the aisle to make House Bill 562 reality. And thank you, Governor Pritzker. Governor, you stood with us on a dark day in Aurora, and we appreciate you returning to stand with us today in this full circle moment. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Governor J.B. Pritzker.
Thank you very much, Mayor Irvin. For the City of Aurora and for its residents, today's announcements are cause for a variety of emotions. I'm grateful for the mayor's leadership through all of it. And on that note, I also want to recognize the quiet strength of every member of the Aurora Police Department. And I want to congratulate Chief Kristen Zeman on her upcoming retirement and thank her for setting an example for all of us in leadership throughout the state of Illinois. On behalf of the state of Illinois, I want to say that this is a day that's been long in coming. Nearly 2.5 years ago, Aurora joined the heartbreaking, ever-growing list of communities that have been devastated by a mass shooting. In the space of one afternoon, the families of the victims saw life as they knew it torn apart, never again to be made whole. Please know that our state will always stand with you, and it's my hope that today we can all do right by the memories of those who were loved and lost. No law can change the past or give back a life. Indeed, I wish we didn't live in a world where lives could be so thoughtlessly and easily stolen in the first place. But today, Illinois is putting policy into force that will save lives. Let me first thank the members of the General Assembly on both sides of the aisle. That includes Leader Dave Kaler, Leader Jay Hoffman, Speaker Chris Welch, Senator Ram Villavalam, Representative Moore Hershauer. We have members on both sides of the aisle representing here, and it's extraordinarily important to recognize that unity. Also leading this effort was our Illinois State Police Director, Brendan Kelly, and his team, our great Attorney General, Kwame Raoul, the Gun Violence Prevention PAC, Moms Demand Action, Live Free Illinois, Prentice and Diane Wynn, and Live Free Rockford, and hosts of voices speaking out on behalf of peace. I failed to mention Representative Wheeler. Keith has been a champion here as well, and helped bring others of his colleagues along to support this bill. The bill that I signed today delivers to Illinoisans everywhere the most comprehensive reform to our state firearms laws in over a generation. Let me repeat that, because it's important. This bill is the most comprehensive reform to our state firearms laws in over a generation. That begins with requiring lawmakers on both sides of the aisle came together to shape this law, steeped in a common sense commitment to safety. That begins with requiring universal background checks on all gun sales in Illinois. Prior to this change, people with dangerous histories who shouldn't possess a weapon, and the Illinois State Police denies firearms licenses to thousands of these individuals a year, could avoid detection through a private sale. That's a deadly loophole. And in Illinois, we're closing that down for good. Of course, making it harder for those who want to do harm to get guns is only one piece of the puzzle. We're also beefing up our ability to detect violent threats and to put a stop to them. That includes properly funding the Illinois State Police in their enforcement efforts to retrieve firearms from people who have lost their license to own a gun. And it means that we're hardening the background check process with stronger identification processes, like fingerprints, so that the Illinois State Police can more easily identify the FOID applicants and firearms purchasers, as well as increase the frequency of the background checks. Responsible gun owners who opt into this process will see their FOID and concealed carry applications expedited, not only at application, but for every renewal thereafter. Crucially, we're also formalizing in law some of the preventative actions that the Illinois State Police has taken under Director Brendan Kelly's leadership so that they don't fall to the wayside in future administrations. That includes giving all Illinois law enforcement agencies access to the FOID status of any individual, ensuring state police continuously monitor federal and state databases for any new threats to safety, requiring every Illinois law enforcement agency to submit ballistics information to national crime databases within 48 hours, and making available to the public all firearms reported stolen to crack down on illegal gun trafficking. We're also making it so that funds from conceal and carry license fees will support community-based trauma-informed mental health programs aimed at reducing gun violence before it starts. I see some people snapping and clapping quietly in the background. It's okay to do it out loud. As we do all of these things to make Illinois safer, we're also taking action to ensure responsible gun owners aren't held back by an antiquated licensing system, which hasn't seen significant updates since its founding more than 50 years ago. So we're streamlining our FOID application process with new electronic options, creating a combined FOID and concealed carry license, and opening up a bipartisan appeals board for those who feel they were wrongly denied a license. In short, In an America where gun violence has become a scourge to so many neighborhoods, Illinois is taking a common sense approach to reform, and we're doing so with votes from both sides of the aisle. I pray, and I really do pray, that not a day too soon, the nation will follow Illinois' lead. With that, I'd like to hand over the podium to a champion, true champion for justice, someone who's been at the forefront of this and so many fights that have mattered, not just on gun safety, but so many issues surrounding justice in our state, and that's our Attorney General, Kwame Raoul. Kwame?
Good morning. Thank you, Governor Pritzker. Thank you, Director Kelly, for your leadership. And to the members, my former colleagues in the General Assembly, thank you for allowing me to come share the podium as a result of the work that you've done along with Director Kelly. And Mayor Irvin, thank you for letting me back into your town. Last time I was here, I proposed to my wife. So, got good luck here. To my colleagues in the General Assembly, I recall years ago when I was in the Senate working on gun legislation that would allow for FOID verification and reporting of lost and stolen weapons, but we knew that back then we had a long, long way to go. And on behalf, and I'd like to again express deepest sympathies to the families, the loved ones who lost their lives during the mass shooting in Aurora, and salute the officers who stepped up to prevent further loss of life in February of 2019. You know, on the day that I took my oath of office to become Illinois Attorney General, I announced that my office would prioritize violence prevention. Effective violence prevention requires a multifaceted approach as reflected in this comprehensive bill. Partnerships between local law enforcement and state and federal government agencies are critical in order to reduce gun violence and violent crime in communities throughout our great state. I commend the Illinois State Police and the legislature for recognizing this and passing this bill as another step in our collective goal to prevent violent crime. It is important to note that this bill passed, as the governor mentioned, with bipartisan support. That don't always happen. And with sponsors who represent districts across the state, showing that violent crime impacts all communities, and efforts to reduce gun violence do not need to be politicized. My office has undertaken steps to partner with local, state, and federal law enforcement agencies to get guns out of the hands of dangerous individuals and curb gun trafficking. We have developed training for law enforcement partners for the implementations of the firearm restraining orders. We have partnered with federal, state, and local authorities to investigate and charge gun running cases. We are currently working with Everytown to build a crime gun tracing platform that will help investigate the source of a crime gun, identify straw purchasers, and provide a big picture look at gun trafficking patterns. And I stand ready to continue to collaborate with Illinois State Police and other law enforcement agencies to effectuate the provisions of 562 that strengthen gun tracing efforts and FOID revocation enforcement. And my office will continue to focus resources on the many ways we can work to prevent gun violence and violent crime. We're also partnering with Secret Service and a National Threat Assessment Center to offer threat assessment trainings to educate and empower individuals to help identify concerning and threatening behaviors with the goal of preventing mass shootings and incidents of gun violence. I also recognize that without access to support and services, today's survivors of violent crimes can become tomorrow's perpetrators. And we have a unique opportunity to interrupt the cycle of violence by providing much needed assistance to crime survivors. This is why we've worked to improve the Illinois Crimes Victims Compensation Program. Through ongoing engagement with community stakeholders, violence prevention experts, service providers, and survivors, we have identified areas for improvement. This has allowed my office to expand the resources available to survivors of violent crime and adjust its policies, operations, and processes to better serve survivors and families with trauma-informed, victim-centered approaches. I'm committed to continuing to use these tools within my office and building upon our partnerships with the Illinois State Police and other law enforcement agencies to work to prevent violent crimes and support crime victims across the state. And I'm committed to continuing to work with the legislature. And with that, I'm going to pass the podium to my colleague and good friend from Peoria, Senator Dave Kaler.
Thank you, Attorney General. Governor, Mr. Speaker, this is an important piece of legislation. First of all, let me express my sympathies to the families that were affected by the tragedy here in Aurora many months ago. The goals of this legislation were really twofold, and Leader Jay Hoffman, who was the House sponsor, and myself understood that as downstate legislators, we had a responsibility to make sure that we had a bill that was fair, that protected responsible gun owners, as well as tried to get at the problem. And so the two goals really that we set out to achieve were, number one, to streamline the FOID process for gun owners so that they would be able to have their FOID cards or applications processed in a timely way. And the governor mentioned some of the processes that are going to take place in this new bill. Secondly, we wanted to enable the Illinois State Police to put the focus on background checks and making sure that people who shouldn't have guns, in fact, don't have guns. And as a responsible gun owner myself, I want to make sure that that FOID renewal process is fair and timely. We owe that to our citizens. But I think something that we can agree on as a common interest is that we need to make sure that our communities are safer. Whether it be rural or urban, upstate or downstate, our communities have to be made safer. And I want to thank a couple of people who really helped to make this all possible. Leader Jay Hoffman in the House, we've sponsored the bill in the House, and to all the members of the House on both sides of the aisle that supported that, to the members of the Senate on both sides of the aisle. Senator Ram Vilivalam, who his teamwork with me was just, I think, very important in terms of making sure that people understood that this was a bill in which we were all coming together on. This is a bill in which we were really seeking to have compromise. And to Director Kelly and his staff, who just did an incredible job. And the one thing that really stands out as just incredibly impressive, Director Kelly, is that your ability to listen and to empathize and to then translate that into some meaningful legislation. Governor, thank you for being here today to sign this. It's very much a pleasure, and I'm very proud to introduce the next speaker, Speaker of the House, Chris Welch.
Thank you, Senator. Good afternoon, everyone. You know, words cannot express how proud I am to be standing here today with my colleagues in the General Assembly on both sides of the aisle to witness our governor sign this momentous legislation. Not only will this legislation modernize and ensure the constitutionality of our FOID system, but more importantly, the governor's signature on this bill today will save lives. The work we did this past session will save lives. It is definitely not lost on me where we are standing here today. Mayor Irvin, thank you for inviting us out here today. Chief Zeman, congratulations on your retirement, and what an amazing, wonderful career you have had. Congratulations to the incoming chief and to all of the members of this dynamic law enforcement department. It was right here in Aurora, 2 years ago, where officers received the horrific news of an active shooter. And it was these officers who ran toward that active shooter, a terrifying scene to protect innocent lives from a very dangerous individual, an individual who would not have been able to have a gun because his FOID card had been revoked. He never should have had a gun. Because he did, 5 souls were lost that day, 6 if you include the shooter, and more were injured. 5 of them were our valiant police officers. We have to thank them each and every day for being the people who would run toward danger and not away from it. So thank you, Aurora Law Enforcement. It breaks my heart to know that this could have been prevented, but it also inspired me, a new Speaker of the House, while my colleagues worked on this legislation, knowing that we would be providing the guidance and resources to do our part to make sure this never happens again. With this bill that Governor Pritzker is signing into law today, state police will monitor the state and federal crime databases to compare them with our FOID license holders and can initiate revocation proceedings. This will ensure that those who are a danger to themselves or others will not have a firearm. I repeat, those who are a danger to themselves or others will not have a firearm. This measure will also incentivize those looking to get a FOID card to provide fingerprints, allowing them to have their card automatically renewed. Not only does this make it more convenient and streamlined, but it's also another means of security to make sure firearms are not in the hands of dangerous individuals. It will require even private gun sales to include a background check to make sure every time a firearm changes hands, it's done so in a safe manner. These are simple, common sense changes that will save lives. And I want to thank all of the advocates for your work that you do. It is not unnoticed. I want to thank the Moms Demand Action for the work they do each and every day to make common sense gun laws like this happen. I want to thank GPAC for their work that they do each and every day. Kathleen Sanchez is a tireless advocate for common sense gun reform. And I certainly want to thank Leader Jay Hoffman, Representative Maura Hershauer, and Senator Kaler for their sincere efforts in getting this legislation on the governor's desk. And I just want to take one moment to particularly thank Representative Hershauer, who really impressed me as a freshman legislator, taking on an experienced legislator like Leader Hoffman. She was a mom on a mission, committed to making this day happen. And I want to make sure we give credit where credit is due. We know that because of the diversity of this state, legislation surrounding firearms can oftentimes be quite difficult, and this was no exception. This bill came together, though, because of compromise, everyone working together. Because we worked together, we made it happen. It has the support from advocates, the Illinois State Police, and hundreds of others. And so, without further ado, I would like to bring up my friend, a leader, a dynamic leader in law enforcement, someone that I enjoy working with each and every day I go to work, our respected director of the Illinois State Police. Please welcome Brendan Kelly.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Governor, the Illinois State Police, in addition to other duties, were responsible for the forensic processing of the crime scene at the Henry Pratt shooting. I will never forget those images, nor will I ever forget the look in the eyes of the officers of the Aurora PD, who will forever live with the scars of that day. Nor can any of us forget the weaknesses in the firearm safety system that were exposed. The Illinois State Police acted and has since conducted more than 450 firearms enforcement details, with over 1,300 prohibited persons placed directly in compliance and over 10,000 firearms dispositions accounted for. And when the pandemic and civil unrest of 2020 led to a massive surge in FOID applications on top of this antiquated renewal process, the brokenness of these statutes were even more apparent. And like so many things that were neglected for decades, you directed us, Governor, to rebuild it and to make it better, to lead the charge in making it first and foremost about the safety of our people. With your stable budgeting, additional staff, and investments in technology, and the hard work of ISP firearms analysts, the new FOID card backlog has been reduced by over 50% since its peak. But we know the law itself has needed to come into the 21st century. In addition to the many efficiencies and safety measures mentioned by others here today, this act creates the framework for voluntary use of fingerprints from other state background check systems, modernizes the drug enforcement statutes of the state so regional Illinois State Police drug trafficking units can investigate co-occurring gun trafficking. And it requires timely submission of ballistics evidence to the National Integrated Ballistic Information Network. That is a key and long-standing request of our federal partners. We've achieved this bipartisan legislation through the values of the Illinois State Police: integrity, service, and pride. By being honest brokers with all stakeholders, by communicating with anyone, anytime, regardless of party or position, and adhering to objective facts and transparently sharing information and evidence for the public and decision makers to enact solid law and strong policy. The ISP mission for firearms enforcement is to focus on safety, not bureaucracy, to make it hard for the bad guys and easier for the good guys. With the most comprehensive state firearms legislation since the creation of FOID, I am grateful to everyone here for the progress today towards fulfilling that mission. Our oaths require it, and the souls of those taken from us demand it. Now, it's my honor and privilege as she ends her career at Aurora PD to introduce my colleague, my friend, the chief of the Aurora Police Department, Chief Kristen Zeman.
Thank you, Director Kelly. 2.5 years ago, our Aurora community was ripped apart when a disgruntled employee shot and killed 5 colleagues at the Henry Pratt Company and wounded 5 of my officers. Those officers saved lives that day as the shooter took aim and one by one shot them as they were attempting to stop him from harming anyone else. What has kept me up at night since that horrific day is that the shooter used a gun he never should have had. He used that gun to steal these precious lives. He had a revoked FOID card, which should have rendered him unable to continue owning a firearm, but a broken system caused the revocation to fall through the cracks. February 15th of 2019, the day of our mass shooting, was a defining moment in my career. While our officers were trained and prepared to respond to an active shooter, nothing could have prepared me for the pain I felt on behalf of the victims' families and our wounded officers. Mr. Wehner, Bonnie, Abby, there's not a day that goes by that I don't think of you. When we uncovered that the shooter had his FOID card revoked, we immediately knew that we needed to help fix a broken system. One of the first conversations I had was with Director Kelly regarding just that, and there was no finger pointing. Instead, it was a vow that we would fix this. My team at APD started working with our lawmakers to keep these illegal guns off the street. My last day as the Aurora Police Chief is this Friday, and it is remarkable to see the work put into action so we can better keep our community safe when it comes to gun violence. Simply expanding background checks on all gun sales, record keeping of those sales, and expanding funding so police can deal with people who don't turn in their revoked FOID cards will help reduce the chance that another person slips through the cracks. This new bill will allow us, the state police, and other law enforcement agencies across Illinois to identify people who unlawfully try to purchase a gun and for the first time create a statewide stolen gun database. This will continue our effort and focus on getting illegal guns off the street and keeping them away from people who wish to do harm. We cannot bring back the precious souls of the lives that were stolen, but we have channeled that pain into action and, God willing, preventing the next shooting by keeping guns out of the hands of those who wish to do harm. Thank you, Governor Pritzker, and to all of our state lawmakers. Thank you for championing this important legislation into law to protect all of our communities. It is my honor to now invite to the microphone the president of the Gun Violence Prevention PAC, Kathleen Sances.
Thank you, Chief. Good afternoon, Governor and Speaker, and all members of the General Assembly. Today, we are here to honor survivors and victims with action. Thank you for being here. After 2 years of advocacy work, supported by tens of thousands of Illinois residents who believe our one job is to keep our communities safe from gun violence, I would like to acknowledge my colleagues, most notably John Gruber, who runs our advocacy program, Dahlia Rodriguez, Simone Gann, and I'm fortunate to have my daughter here today, Lily Mahalik. A special thank you to the over 200 organizations of the Illinois Gun Violence Prevention Coalition, including Every Town for Gun Safety, Giffords, Brady United, the Coalition to Stop Gun Violence, Lurie Children's Hospital, the Heartland Alliance, and two local members who are with us today, Reverend Sierra Bates Chamberlain from Live Free, Illinois, and Valerie Samutis, Organizing Manager for Moms Demand Action in Illinois and Indiana. And finally, Tom Vandenberg, founder of GPAC, and currently serving as interim president and CEO of UCAN. We are stronger when we stand united to fight gun violence. All the elected officials and the directors standing behind me, in fact, all 115 lawmakers who voted yes on this historic legislation, thank you. Governor Pritzker, who I've stood now twice to sign a major piece of life-saving legislation. Thank you. We are also joined here today by survivors of gun violence. It is due to their tragedy and their bravery that we are gathered today. We have the six survivors who were lost here in Aurora, and also with us today, Delphine Cherry, Valerie Samutis, Tom Vandenberg, and we're honoring Prentice and Diane Wynn. From the bottom of my heart to all the survivors and victims, thank you. 2 years ago, GPAC started bringing together many of the people in this room. Our goal was to stop the flow of illegal guns into our communities and fix the major loophole in our gun laws that led to the Henry Pratt shooting. But as we organized to fix the FOID and block illegal gun ownership into the fold, powered by their courage, we set out to tackle the many ways that gun violence destroys our states, in particular, Black and brown communities. We organized to enact universal background checks. We fought for greater mental health investments for impacted communities. We demanded that we change our laws to require the Illinois State Police to remove guns from revoked void card holders. We worked to create a stolen gun database, and we fought for expanded fingerprinting of void card applicants. And we refused to take no for an answer, even when the global pandemic shifted attention from our gun violence epidemic. Today, I am proud to report back that the bill Governor Pritzker will sign includes all of that and even more. In this process, we set an example for the nation. We showed that gun violence prevention advocates can work with law-abiding gun owners to pass common sense public safety measures. Of course, our work is not done. So far this year, there have been 1,915 shootings in Chicago, and 434 people have been murdered with guns. That includes 114 shootings and 22 people murdered just 1 week ago. This bill does not bring them back, but we are going to continue to work. And the scourge of gun violence will not go away overnight. Today is a good day. We made our state and country a safer place. We started tackling a major equity issue that disproportionately affects our Black and Brown communities, and we did our one most important job, keeping our communities and kids safe. Thank you, Governor Pritzker. It is now my honor to introduce survivor Abby Parks.
Good afternoon. My name is Abby Parks, and my son Axel is here with me today. I am here today as a mother, a widow, and a survivor who lost my husband and Axel's father, Clay Parks, in the Henry Pratt Company mass shooting here in Aurora. I want to tell you about the loving father and supportive husband Clay was. I want to tell you he was the type of friend that always had your back, that he was fiercely loyal to the people he loved. But the truth is, Clay was so much to so many people that it's hard to put into words the kind of person he was, because nothing I really say even scratches the surface. But his absence in everyday life is felt by all those who knew and loved him. Since Axel and I lost Clay, I have worked to keep his memory and legacy alive. Part of that work means addressing the fact that Clay and the four others taken that day could still be with us if illegal guns were not left in the hands of people with revoked FOID cards. The shooter at the Henry Pratt Company had his FOID card revoked, which means he was legally prohibited from having a gun, yet he was able to keep his weapon. However, House Bill 562, which Governor Pritzker will sign today, requires Illinois State Police to remove guns from the people who have had their FOID cards revoked but do not relinquish their weapons, like the man who killed Clay. Once it becomes law, HB 562 will save lives and save families from experiencing the loss and pain that my family lives with every day. Governor Pritzker and members of the General Assembly, thank you for honoring Clay and those lost with action. And now, here's Governor J.B. Pritzker.
major, Bill's major sponsor should hold this up for a picture. Where's Maura? I'm happy to take questions from members of the media.
Yes, Governor. Thank you, sir. How soon will the state have the staffing and resources available to implement these expanded gun background checks? And could you also offer a comment, sir, about the current mask situation in our local schools and the debate that it's causing in our communities?
Sure. Let me call on our director of ISP to answer the first part of your question. I'll come back and answer it.
I'll let the governor answer the mask question. But I can try to answer the question about staffing. We've already begun, as a result of the stability and the recent budgets that have been passed, been able to have an actual hiring plan and build out the staffing that's necessary in the State Police Firearms Services Bureau. So we have doubled the number of firearms eligibility analysts and have some additional staff that we've augmented to try to tackle the backlog and make sure that there's no backlog when it comes to the background check process. We've been able to reduce it from its peak by half as a result of that. In addition, because of that stable budgeting and not sweeping those funds as been done in previous years, we have now the ability to invest in the technology that's needed to streamline this process, but not just streamline the process, but also be able to more quickly zero in on the individuals who are potential threats, have more accurate identification. So that process has already begun. With the changes that are in this bill, where the FOID fee will be reallocated half to administration, half to enforcement, we will now have a dedicated funding stream that will go to those things that are necessary to administer the program, but also a funding stream which never existed before that will go to hiring additional police officers that will do that enforcement, as well as augmenting the current budget that we have to pay for things like overtime, to pay for the extra work that's necessary to maintain these firearms enforcement details. As I've mentioned, since the Henry Pratt shooting, we've done over 450 of those details, but that was with existing resources. So now we're going to take the extra resources that come as a result of this legislation being passed and be able to build that out and make sure that we're covering as many revokees as possible to ensure that the firearms disposition reports, where we account for those firearms, that number continues to grow, where we have the number of revokees and then the number of dispositions accounted for, and then we close that gap so that we get closer and closer to be able to account for every firearm that may have been in the hands of someone who's been revoked.
With regard to masks, let me begin by saying that the CDC issued guidance, as you know, last week, which we've adopted already for the state of Illinois through the Illinois Department of Public Health. Strong recommendation that people who are in indoor environments mask up, that in schools, recommendation that kids mask up. And I must say that, you know, we should be encouraging everybody, and I need to say this over and over again, anybody that has not been vaccinated, this is the best way to stay safe. Get vaccinated. If you've not been vaccinated, get vaccinated. And it's available to you right now. Within an hour, you could be at a Walgreens, a CVS, at one of our departments of public health across the state getting vaccinated. It's free. It's free and it's widely available, so please go do it. And again, we're going to do everything we can to keep up with not only that guidance, but also local governments, local officials have the ability to put in stronger mitigations if they want to, if they need to.
I've got a couple of questions, and then I've got a couple of questions that have come into me. First of all, I guess, how do you enforce the private sales aspect of this? The reality that police find all the time is that the criminals always find a way to get a gun. So how much is this really going to make a difference?
Well, I'm going to take the second part of that first, and then I'm going to ask the director to come up. Look, we are constantly chasing all the ways that criminals are attempting to get around the law. That's just a fact of life. But every loophole we close, we get closer and closer to safety for our communities. And that's why, you know, I wouldn't look at this as the end of a process, but nonetheless a beginning of a process to make sure that we are keeping illegal guns out of the hands of people who shouldn't have them.
Let
Well, to the governor's point, public safety, and particularly when you're talking about gun violence, is often a game of inches. And it's every little inch that matters, every little measure that you can take that will reduce the chances that someone will have access to a firearm that shouldn't. We know there are many, many sources of illegal firearms. We know that they come from originally legal sources and they wind up making their way into the illegal gun market. One of those ways, right now, every year there's about 40 to 50,000 private transfers that occur in this state that are not subject to a federal background check. With this legislation, we will be putting a system in place that will create actually options to make sure that those private transfers go through a federal background check. They'll be able to either do it online or they'll be able to do it at an FFL. We've given them that option. That was part of the compromise that was worked out in this bill that made common sense for lawful gun owners. And by requiring a federal background check, you're going to reduce the chances that that firearm is transferred to someone who shouldn't have it. In addition, there are additional record keeping requirements. So when law enforcement comes across a firearm that is seized in the course of illegal conduct or illegal use of a firearm, then we can see what the record process, the record retention process that's in place will help us to be able to see who's the last person that had it legally, where did it come from before. That's all part of a web that's necessary to fight gun trafficking. So this is one of those measures. Is it a panacea? Is it a fix-all? No, but every little thing that we can do, every little loophole we can close, every inch that we can gain in public safety, it all adds up to be able to reduce the chances that someone's going to be killed by a firearm.
Director Kelly, if you can step there just for another question. If you could explain how the electronic combined firearm card would work.
Yes, yeah, so right now we have two statutory situations where, at least before this legislation was passed and signed today, where you have a FOID card that's under the FOID statute and a concealed carry license. That was a result of a court decision that required the state to put a concealed carry license process in place. Now, those are two different licenses, but many of the background check processes actually are redundant and they overlap. So by combining the FOID and CCL, for individuals who have a concealed carry license card, instead of carrying around two cards that have two different processes and two different fees, we'll be able to combine those into a single thing that's good not just for them, for those lawful gun owners in terms of a convenience, but it's also good for us. That means that less paperwork, less bureaucracy, less effort we have to put into someone we know has already been validated through either one of those processes by combining them into a single thing. That'll help us to concentrate again on people who are threats to public safety instead of a bureaucratic work that doesn't really add much to the public safety equation.
Let's get one back here. You had a question?
Oh, I was going to ask about private gun sales to the ISP director. Will private gun sales then be subject to the same rules, regs as commercial gun sales as far as waiting periods, et cetera?
So the current, before the legislation was passed, private transfers, the only requirement was that someone had to go online and look to see if the person they were giving the card to had a valid FOID card. But that, again, did not cover all the federal requirements that exist when someone goes in to purchase a firearm at a federally licensed firearm dealer. What this process does, and with the changes in this legislation, will mirror now those federal requirements. In terms of the waiting time and that process, that is a little more complicated. But in essence, is what we've made sure that this chunk of sales and transfers that occurs on a regular basis will now have that same imprimatur. Will now have that same look of the person who's receiving the firearm to make sure that there's nothing in the federal system as well. That is the essence of a universal background check by putting this process in place.
And we have time for one more. Governor, if I could just, on a political side of things, some GOP critics say this is kind of just a gateway to mandating fingerprints and an assault on Second Amendment rights. Can you respond to that?
This is compromise legislation that had bipartisan support. So I know there are people who may have more extreme view of what should or shouldn't happen, perhaps on both sides of the aisle. What I know is that people came together in the middle to try to find the right way forward. And I'm actually very proud of the fact that a number of people, including Representative Wheeler and others, worked hard on this bill. And again, it isn't everything that gun safety advocates wanted. It isn't everything that those who are, support the Illinois State Rifle Association and other organizations wanted. But this was the right way forward. And again,
progress. Progress has been made, and I think everybody that was on this bill that was part of this effort, including Representative Costa Howard, who I forgot to recognize here, everybody that was on this bill felt like maybe it wasn't perfect and everything that they wanted, but it was something that they were able to reach a compromise and make progress on.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone. Could I ask Chief Seaman, would you mind gathering the family members and maybe we could get a picture with them with this piece of legislation because they were vitally important. Chief Seaman, do you want to get in the picture?